Welcome to Gethsemane Baptist Temple, the voice of Calvary. Located in Star, South Carolina, we are a lively, old-time, Bible-believing, camp-meeting-style church where the shout has not died out. Join us now as our pastor, Sam Duncan, brings this week's message.
Music is in the air. All the lights are on the trees. Love is everywhere. I hear a song of long ago about the Father, Son. I love all the holidays, but not as much as this one. Why I love Christmas. It's a special time of year. Why I love Christmas. Bringing hope and lots of cheer. A child that was born on that morning brought the gift of salvation to us. That's why I love Christmas. Children are excited, 'cause now is Christmas Eve. They're anticipating what Santa Claus will eat. When I see all the presents, boxes and pretty bows, I picture baby Jesus wrapped in swaddling clothes. Why I love Christmas. It's a special time of year. Why I love Christmas. Bringing hope and lots of cheer. A child that was born on that morning brought the gift of salvation to us. And that's why I love Christmas. Child that was born on that morning brought the gift of salvation to us. That's why I love Christmas. That's why I love Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Would you turn with me this morning to Matthew chapter 2? There are two prevalent places in the scripture that tells us about the birth of Christ. One is Matthew, the other one Luke, and we'll be in that one next week. But for this morning, Matthew chapter 2. I'll ask for your undivided attention. We'll do a little skip reading, try to tie some things together. Matthew chapter 2, let's begin reading in verse 1. Verse 1 says, "Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ, or where this Messiah was supposed to be born. He had no clue. He was spiritually illiterate, although he was king. Verse 8, drop down verse 8. And he sent them to Bethlehem, and said, go and search diligently for the young child. And when you found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. Verse 11. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod. Drop down to verse 16. It'll be the last verse we'll read. Verse 16. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew, listen to this, killed all the children that were in Bethlehem and all the coasts thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. We got two pictures here, and these same two pictures are played out in modern times. You have some that treat Christmas as a holy event. It's about Jesus being born. I got ahead of myself. There'd be no empty tomb if there'd not been a cross. There'd not been a cross if there'd not been a manger. So for some, we worship the Christ of Christmas, and it's a holy event. But we also see at the first Christmas, some treated it as a heathen event. And I want you to know you've got a decision to make. 1 week from today is Christmas Eve. A week from tomorrow, naturally Christmas. Now, is Christmas going to be a heathen event, or is it going to be a holy event? The choice is up to you. I want to preach a little bit on how will you celebrate Christmas. Let's pray, and after prayer, you may be seated. Our Father God, we come this right now in Jesus' mighty name. And Lord, we do thank you for every man, woman, boy, and girl that made it to church on this rainy Sunday. I just pray, God, that your spirit be upon us. I'm asking, Lord, for your anointing. I pray you'd anoint the preacher and the preaching. And then, Lord, I ask that you'd anoint the hearer and the listener, and God, that this message find lodging in every heart, and let us realize that some will celebrate Christmas the proper way, and some will celebrate it in an improper way. I just ask, God, that the Holy Ghost be real. I thank you for meeting with us in that early service already. Thank you for the good spirit and the time of worship. I thank you, God, for this one that's already been saved. Back in the office a little bit before we started this service. Now, I ask, God, that you'd be with us in this service now. Meet every need. We pray it, and we ask it, our Father, in the mighty and the matchless name of the Lord Jesus, we humbly pray. And I ask you to give Jesus the gift of praise this morning by saying what? Amen. Say it again. Amen. Amen. And amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Let me begin this morning by saying that people from all walks of life will celebrate Christmas. For those of us that are saved, born again in the family of God, we'll worship and we'll celebrate Christmas as a holy thing. We'll rejoice over the fact that we don't have to go to hell For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Can you give him a little praise this morning? But that's for us. But wait a minute, there'll be another crowd. But let me tell you, they will celebrate Christmas also. But they celebrate it for a whole different reason than we do. The reason some people celebrate Christmas is because it's built into the calendar and they get a couple of days off. Some people, are you listening? Some people will take a holy thing and turn it into a heathen thing. I got news for you. I want you to hear me out. I'll never forget years ago, the first time I heard this ungodly statement. I heard another man, I had one man ask another man, have you bought your Christmas liquor yet? Let me tell you, my Savior is holy. He's righteous. He's perfect. And the last thing anybody ought to try to do is to get drunk in the name of Jesus. That's the biggest hypocritical thing that I've ever heard of. Somebody give me an amen. I mean, they'll use it to have an office party. People will get drunk. They'll get so drunk, they'll dance with the Christmas tree thinking they got them a fat woman. Somebody say something. Come on now. And oh, what about that bunch of heathen that write names down and put it in the hat and say, draw it out and get your gift. And whoever's name you drew out, then they commit immorality together. And all of that, Brother Travis, is being done at Christmas as a form of celebrating Christmas. I'm telling you, it's the most wicked. It's the most hideous. It's the most ungodly thing that anybody could ever do. Let me tell you right now, anything that supersedes Jesus is a smoke screen that the devil has put up to try to get people to not see and recognize and know what Christmas is all about. Anybody with a brain, no, you can't say the word Christmas without first saying the word Christ. It's about Jesus. But listen, all this hideous heathen activity didn't start last Christmas. It started way back there with a man named Herod. I mean, right there in the Christmas story, it tells us about two forms of worship. Thank God the wise men, when they came to where Jesus was, they fell down. They got down on their knees in front of the Christ child, and they began to worship and give him praise. Thank God the angels danced across the sky using stars for stepping stones, saying glory to God in the highest. Somebody say something. Man alive. But then you had this other crowd, and their Christmas was about greed and jealousy and oh yeah, murder. Killed every baby under 2 years old in Bethlehem. And when it said in the coast thereof, that means the surrounding area. Oh, Herod was filled with hatred and ungodliness. And so when they came and said, we know the Messiah's coming. We know that Christ is coming. And we come to worship him. And Herod was the king. Pardon me, he got mad as fire that somebody else would get more recognition than him. He's king. And they've come telling them there's a new king coming to town. Let me tell you, people that were wise back then, they might not have known the day They might not have known the date. They didn't know what day of the week it was, but they knew that one day the Messiah was coming. And they saw his star and come. That's just like us. I might not know the day. I might not know the hour. I don't know the month. But I'm here to tell you that same Messiah, he's coming back. He's been here, died on the cross, defeated death, hell, and the grave, rose from the dead, ascended back to the right hand of the Father. But I'm here to serve notice on Santa Claus. I'm here to serve notice on the elves. King Jesus is coming back again. And buddy, he will be king, and there won't be another. So I got only 2 points to my message this morning. Somebody said, oh boy, we'll get out early. Oh, wait a minute. Under each point, I got a bunch of sub-points. The 2 points, some people have a heathen Christmas. And the second point, some will have a holy Christmas. Let's look at this, and I'm going to show you scripture for every bit of it. Number one, let's see, a heathen Christmas. You say, well, Sam, I don't like the term. Well, that's not my problem. It's still heathen when you make something else God instead of the true God. Let me say, a heathen Christmas revolves first around jealousy. Let me show you a jealous king. Whoever's at the computer back there, pop up the first verses we put in the computer. We just read it, but I want everybody to see it on the big screen. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem saying, where is he that's born king of the Jews? Now, wait a minute. You automatically see a conflict. Here's Herod seated on the throne. I'm the big boss man. I'm the king. And now they've shown up looking for another king. They said, where is he born king of the Jews? We've seen his star in the east. We've come to worship him. And when Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled. He was bent out of shape. He said, pardon me, I'm going to paraphrase. He said, I ain't nobody getting my throne. I ain't nobody going to take over here. I am the king. So folks, I see in that story, first of all, in the original Christmas story, there was somebody there that celebrated Christmas with jealousy. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I'm here to tell you, if you get jealous this Christmas, it's because you're celebrating it the wrong way. Amen. Hey, if somebody else gets something and you don't get it, people get all mean. Oh, yeah, that's the Christmas spirit, isn't it? Well, bless God, they got a watch and I didn't, and they got this and I did. When you're living for that, you're celebrating Christmas the wrong way right out of the gate. Somebody say amen. So I'm here to tell you a heathen Christmas revolves first around jealousy. Second, a heathen Christmas revolves around ignorance. What do you mean, Brother Sam, ignorance? Pop up verse 4, please. When he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. Guess what? He's king. He's probably an educated man. He might have more degrees than a thermometer, but he has no clue about the coming king of prophecy. Wait a minute. If he lived in the days of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that meant he had all the Old Testament days from Adam and Eve all the way through to Malachi, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, all of that. And he knew nothing about current events in the light of Scripture. Guess what? He was totally ignorant. He had to call a cabinet meeting. He got the chief priests, the scribes together. He said, somebody's got to tell me, is there a scripture that says something about a Messiah, a king that is coming? Oh, yeah, king, it sure does. It tells us he's coming, and he's coming to Bethlehem. The first time, let me announce to you, he's coming to Jerusalem the second time to sit upon the throne of his father David. But here we see a heathen Christmas revolves around ignorance. He didn't even have a clue what was happening. Like people today, some people have no clue what Christmas is really about. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. You say amen and I won't sing. Blue Christmas. Santa Claus is coming to town. How a lot of people are totally ignorant. Let me tell you, Christmas is supposed to be a spiritual holiday, a time to worship and a time to praise the true and living God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Listen, Jesus is God come down to man to save our nasty soul and to birth us in to the family of God where we miss hell and live in the glory world for all of eternity. And you're going to make a big deal about a reindeer. You're going to make a big deal about some holly. Talk to me. Man, I see in the very first Christmas, some celebrated it the wrong way, a heathen Christmas. It revolves around jealousy, and it revolves around ignorance. There's a third thing, leave that verse up. There's a third thing, a heathen Christmas will revolve around bitterness and anger. There's a word here that tells the story. He gathered all the chief priests, the scribes, and the people together, and he demanded, look this way. He beat on his desk, or he beat on the table in front of him. He had those chief priests and scribes, and he beat. You know what? He's mad at himself, but he's taking it out on other people. He's mad now at the chief priest. He's mad at the scribes because he doesn't know. Boy, is that not a commentary on human nature? There's something missing in your life, so you just get mad at somebody else about it. Talk to me. Oh, my soul. He demanded of them. He's bitter. He's angry. A heathen Christmas revolved around jealousy and ignorance and bitterness and anger. Oh, and I might ought to preach this next point from behind the pulpit. The fourth thing about a heathen Christmas, it revolves around a pack of lies. A pack of lies. Pop up the next verse, please. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child. When you found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. I bet that joker's pants were on fire. You ever heard the little saying, liar, liar, your pants on fire? He had no intention. He had no plan of ever worshiping Jesus. And you read with me the rest of the story. He was so arrogant and so mean and so hateful, not in order to try to ensure that he's killed off baby Jesus. He kills every child in Bethlehem under 2 years of age. Killed them all. He knew that when he said that. What he was trying to do is to find out where baby Jesus was and try and go kill him right then and there. So you know what? Heathen Christmas revolved around lies. Uh-oh, look out now. Look out now. There's that elf on the shelf. Come on now. You better do right. The elf's watching you. Now, wait a minute. There's somebody watching you besides an elf. If you don't have any better control over your children, that you got to lie to them and bribe them to try to get them to halfway live right and do right, you got a bigger problem than just that. Somebody talk to me now. Hey, give him the gift of Christmas praise. Amen. So I see the first Christmas lies were right there, came from Herod. And boy, mankind picked up on it. Boom, and they went with it. Lie, lie, lie. Christmas is about a Savior. Anything that comes up and hides the truth of that. Let me tell you something. Let me give each mama and daddy a quick word of advice. Let me tell you, if today were Roger's birthday, and I showed up and I gave Jimmy a gift, and Ricky a gift, and Brandon a gift, and Earl a gift, and Jennifer a gift, and Travis a gift, and Joe a gift, and overlooked the one who it really was his birthday. Would that make a lick of sense? Well, let me tell you, Christmas is about the birth of Christ. We're honoring everybody that we know, and nothing wrong with showing love, but you need to be showing love to the one. It's the birth of Christ. And let me tell you something. I'm a parent and a grandparent, and if any of my family, and it were their birthday, and people came, and oh, they're making big over everybody and ignoring my child. And it's my child's birthday. And man, they making a big deal. Bless you all, blah, 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 blah. And leave your little 3 or 4 or 5 year old child sitting over there, tears in their eyes. I don't care who you are. If you're much of a parent, you're going to get upset at that. Well, let me tell you, Jesus has a father. What about John 3:16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He's the son of God. And when we recognize and honor and make a big deal about everybody else and ignore Jesus, I believe it breaks the heart of God to see his son pushed to the side, neglected and rejected, but yet do it in a pack of lies. Ooh-wee. If you won't say amen, say ooh-wee. Am I telling the truth this morning? I hope I'm telling the truth every Sunday morning. Amen. And then number 5, a heathen Christmas revolves around all kinds of sin. We see it already. We see lies and jealousy and ignorance and anger and bitterness. But let me even show you one more. Pop up verse 16. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked to the wise men when they didn't go back to him, he was exceeding wroth. Wroth, W-R-O-T-H, means boiling mad. Man, the first Christmas, you had people that worshiped and celebrated the holy way. We'll see in a minute. But we see them celebrating it in the heathen way. And let me say the last point under this category. A heathen Christmas revolves around doing wrong by the children. It revolves around doing wrong by the children. Notice what happened first Christmas. Herod, when he saw his mock the wise man, men was exceeding wroth and sent forth and slew or killed all the children that were in Bethlehem and all the coasts, the surrounding area, from 2 years old and under. I know you'd never do anything like that. I don't even know anybody that I would put in that kind of a category. But there are parents that are doing wrong by their children at Christmas. When you never tell them about Christ. When you let commercialism be the king of Christmas, when you let it be about commercialism instead of Christ, you're doing wrong by the children. Let me tell you, there's never been a child that didn't love Christmas. And if you could start out with that child and show them, if you got a star on the top of the tree, you can tell them the story of the wise men followed the star. When you have gifts under it, tell them about the gift of salvation that came under the tree of Christ. When you see decorations of red, tell them about the blood of Jesus and use Christmas as a spiritual thing instead of a commercial, greedy, jealous kind of thing. It has absolutely nothing to do. There are parents right now. I guarantee them, somebody hears this online or on TV. When I said some people do wrong by their children, some parents say, well, not me. I spent $2,500 on each of my children. Yeah, go ahead and spoil them. Turn them into heathen. It's not about the amount of money you spend or the things like that. You're doing wrong by your children when you don't tell them the truth. And the truth is, there's a Savior, and when you get past out those gifts, all you got to do is tell them, if you remember, Jesus is offering us the gift of salvation. We didn't buy it. We don't earn it, but all we got to do is reach out and accept it. And man, they can use Christmas as a great spiritual illustration, and they get saved. Just a little bit ago, old Ricky right back there, I know he's kind of somewhat of a visitor, but he caught up with me and we went back in the office, and boy, he accepted that gift. I didn't have a box with a bow on it. I told him about a man named Jesus had put purpose in your life, put joy in your life, give peace to your life, give direction to your life, and he reached out and accepted that gift about an hour or so ago. Somebody, woo, praise the Lord. But when you do wrong by children, all those things equate to a heathen Christmas. Roman numeral number 2, let's see now, a holy Christmas. I'm going to ask you to make a decision right now today. You know, Joshua, he made that decision, and it's recorded in the Bible. Joshua said, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. I want to ask you to make a decision right now. Here in my house, Christmas will be about Christ. I'm not trying to destroy any fun for the kids. I've got grandchildren. You can still do it, but you got to do it in the right context. Let them know, because the wise men gave gifts to Jesus. By the way, they were recognizing who he was. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Each of those gifts represents one of the offices that Jesus holds: prophet, priest, and king. Man, and they gave those gifts. You can show you love, you should, but let it be in the right and proper way. I'm asking you to make the decision now that we're going to keep this thing right. Well, what is a godly Christmas? Number one under this category, a godly Christmas will be all about Jesus. Pop up verse 1. You saw it earlier. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, Christmas is all about God pouring himself into a human body. See, God in the form of God cannot die. So God put himself in a human form, came down and went to the cross, took your sin, and my sin on him and died. But because he was God, he then rose back from the dead. And let me tell you, what greater, that is a whole lot better than chestnuts roasting on an open fire. I'm glad that I got some good news. Maybe you've been a drunk. Maybe you've been a drug addict. Maybe you've been the most hideous person. All you got to do is focus on Jesus and realize he's got the best gift that can ever be received. You didn't buy it. You didn't earn it. You might not even deserve it. But aren't you glad there's a God that cared enough about your nasty soul that he gave you the gift of salvation? Shame on us to focus on anything else. Word of advice, young parents. On Christmas, fix Jesus a birthday cake. It is his birthday. Let the kids see that at a young age, that this is about Jesus. Tell them about the wise men that showed their love and they gave the gifts. And because we love you, that's why we're giving gifts. But it's all about Jesus. So the first thing to have a godly Christmas or a holy Christmas, it's got to revolve around Jesus. Then there's a second thing. And I'm about to Lord a boom. Second thing, a godly Christmas is about worship. Pop it up. Next verse, please. Saying, where is he, born King of the Jews? We've seen his star in the east, and we've come to worship him. Let me tell you something I don't like. I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to preach against it long as I got breath in my body. I believe it's the most hypocritical thing that a church could do is to cancel worship services on Christmas. You're proving that Santa Claus is your God. I said, Brother Sam, I don't like you to talk that straight. Well, you want me to tell you the truth, don't you? Hey, listen to me. There might be one person out of that congregation, just like this brother came in this morning. I talked to him last night and asked him about church. He's here, and he got right with God. What if he showed up and we weren't having church? Somebody say something. Are you with me this morning? I think it's the most hideous, hypocritical thing ever for a church to cancel worship on Christmas. Somebody give me an amen. Lord, have mercy. That proves you're about something else instead of Jesus. I'm all about family. You'll never find a more family-oriented person. And I like having time with family. But listen, I don't believe in booting Jesus out or booting the house of God out. But it says they came to worship. Christmas is about worship. Now, as I said, next Sunday night, we'll be sensible. We know it's a family thing. You've been at church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and we'll let you be able to do both. Come to church, worship God, have our candlelight, and still have some family time. But there's churches all over America. Listen to me. I'm not being mean-spirited. Have already canceled for next week. Not just Sunday night, but Sunday morning. That's the 24th. That's not even, hey, when Christmas falls on Sunday, we still have church on Christmas Day, Sunday morning. But on Christmas Eve and not even bother to have church. You say, Brother Sam, you blowing off steam? No, you call this preaching. And it's truth. How bigger hypocritical can someone be than to cancel because somebody in the congregation might want to be there, and if you're not there for them, they can't. You're forcing them against it. It's about worship. And as another verse said, they came into the house where they were. They fell down and they worshiped Jesus. I got news for you. God's been good to me. God has blessed me. God has met my need. God has taken care of me. And let's just look at this year of 2023. We got this week, next week, and then the 31st is on a Sunday, New Year's Eve, and this year's gone. But you know what? God's been so good to me all year long. I'd feel like a hill to say, well, I'm going to go put my emphasis on a fat man in a red suit. I'm not going to put my emphasis on the God that's been so good to me and has blessed me. There's a word for that. It's called hypocrite. Ooh, Lordy, Lordy, Lordy. Somebody say, ooh-wee. Well, praise the Lord. A godly Christmas, the third thing, is supposed to revolve around rejoicing in the Lord. Verse 10, I got ahead of myself. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. Now, let me tell you, they've not even seen Jesus yet. These are the wise men. That miraculous star that led them has appeared. And just because they saw the star, they knew that they were soon going to see Jesus. They didn't know if it's going to be 30 minutes or 30 days, but when they saw the star, they knew they're soon going to see Jesus. Well, let me tell you, I don't know exactly when, but I believe we're all soon going to see Jesus. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God. The dead in Christ arise first, and those of us that are alive and remain will be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with those words. They saw the star, and they went ahead and started rejoicing. And they did it with exceeding great joy. Amen. Folks, I can understand why people are depressed and sad at Christmas if you're not focused on the right thing. When you focus on the Lord, it'll bring some rejoicing and joy your way. It's not about trying to outdo the next person. It's not trying to give a better gift to your family than what your neighbor gave to them. Oh, that's jealousy and competition. What has that got to do with the real meaning of Christmas? I'm telling you, we need to rejoice in the Lord. I've said it twice already. Let me make it three times. If there'd be no empty tomb, if there'd not been a cross. Had not been a cross, if it had not been a manger. All my hope, I love the song, all my hope is in Jesus. All my yesterdays are gone. And the hope that I have in Jesus is because he came that first Christmas. So a holy Christmas, a godly Christmas, revolves around Jesus, revolves around worship. It revolves around rejoicing in the Lord. Fourthly, a godly Christmas revolves around humility. Show me verse 11, please. And when they were come into the house, They saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and notice it says they fell down and worshiped. Now, wait a minute. These wise men probably came from one of the Middle Eastern universities of the day. They knew that the lining up of all those stars was significant. They knew it was out of the ordinary. They knew that there had to be God behind all that. These men were highly educated, and they were called wise men. But when these men that were called wise came to Jesus, they fell down. They said, I don't even need to stand in his presence. Christmas ought to be about humility, humbling ourselves before the Lord. My goodness. Woo! Humble before him. Man. Lord, pardon me, I got goosebumps. Lord, have mercy. Who do we think we are to put ourselves here and Jesus way down there? That thing ought to be flip-flopped. He needs to be high and lifted up, and we need to humble ourselves and fall down before him. And then the last thing I'm going to have time for, a godly or a holy Christmas would revolve around showing your love. Pop that verse back up, please. They presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold was the gift that you'd give the king. The frankincense and myrrh, that was represented the prophet and the priest. They gave it. You know what they said? Jesus is everything. Listen, we need to show our love. Nothing wrong with showing your love to your spouse, showing your love to your children, showing your love to your grandchildren and your family in general. But at Christmas, don't you think of all times we ought to show our love to the Lord? I know it's a cliche, but Jesus really is the reason for the season. How much do you love him? Do you love him enough to put him first? Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. You put God first, God will take care of the rest of it. He'll add it to you. He'll make sure that you got what you need. But so many people put themselves first. And at this time of the year, so many people are putting somebody else first. I got news for you. Frosty the Snowman didn't die on the cross for you. Santa Claus did not die on the cross for you. Frosty didn't raise from the dead. Rudolph didn't rise from the dead. But I can tell you about one that did. Folks, we ought to love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's kind of the way you're closing out the year. And there'll be people all over America never darken the door of a church, Christmas or any other time. And there'll be people that go to church all year long. And if you're going to be out of town, I'm not throwing a rock. But there'll be people live two houses from the church and won't get up and go on Christmas because something else is their God. You know what? Christian people love their children and grandchildren the same as anybody else. But we just got enough of a conviction that we got to put the Lord in his proper place. Twinkle, twinkle, little star. Shine on, Star of Bethlehem. And I like the part that said, Jesus is now the star divine. Brighter and brighter, he must shine. Lead us on to that perfect day. Those people here in that day of the scriptures, they knew a Messiah. The wise people knew he was coming. They didn't know when, didn't know the month, the day, or the hour, but they knew he was coming. 2,000 years have come and gone, and people that are wise today, we don't know the day, the hour, the month, or the week, but people that are wise will know that he's coming again. On this Sunday preceding Christmas, I want to present a gift. You know, when you get a gift, you don't buy it, you don't earn it. You may not even deserve it, but you just got to reach out and take it and receive it. I want you to imagine Jesus with a nail-scarred hand and a gift worth more than millions. You talk to anybody, it's gone to hell. If it had been a multi-billionaire, would it be? They'd swap everything they had to be able to go and be with the Lord in heaven. Christmas. Don't celebrate it just because it's December the 25th next week. Celebrate it in the proper way, recognizing it's about Jesus. Don't let a smoke screen hide the truth. And don't participate and be a part of the smoke screen and perpetuate the smoke screen for your children and grandchildren. Make it about the Lord, especially if you lay claim to salvation yourself. Let's pray. Our Father God, thank you today for the privilege of being in your house. Lord, thank you for the attention and the attendance, both early service and now in this one. And Lord, how people have certainly been attentive. And I pray that the message has found true lodging in every heart. And let us decide right now that Christmas is going to have a spiritual meaning. Christmas is not another day like Columbus Day. It's not another day like Groundhog's Day. It's not another day even like Valentine's Day, but it's a day that honors our entire eternal future. Help us to treat it with the respect and the seriousness that we should. We ask it, our Father, in the mighty, matchless name of King Jesus, we pray. Amen.
And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, "Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us." Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and the scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. They said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it's written by the prophet, 'And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.'" Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child, And when you have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw him, saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother. And they fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed unto their own country another way.
We hope you have enjoyed this week's broadcast of Gethsemane Baptist Temple, the voice of Calvary. We invite you to join us here each week. Or better yet, join us on Sunday at 6116 Highway 81 South in Star, South Carolina. For more information, visit us online at www.gbtemple.com. We look forward to seeing you in church Sunday.